Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hi, I'm Mark Reasinger, the creator of the Ambullneo Mastiff. The breed is a conglomeration of five different dogs or six different breeds. Okay, so what I mean by that is the different dogs that are in the breed are all specimens. Every one of them was a specimen. And so it was a English Mastiff to a Neapolitan female, Neapolitan Mastiff female, and that was bred to a game-bred pit bull. And the offspring of that was set aside, and a Scott-type American bulldog was bred to a bull Mastiff, a big dog, a big bull Mastiff with a huge head and a great temperament. I think his head was 34 inches in circumference. And then the offspring of those two were bred together, and that created the F1 breeding stock. So we repeated that process three more times and started doing kind of what you would call like a braid. So basically, the breeding program is the sire of the sire is the same as the grandsire of the dam on the dam side. And for a dog breeder understand how that's bred. There was a gentleman named Tudor years ago who bred American Pit Bull Terriers, and he used that same breeding program. There was another man named Mosley who bred Bull Mastiffs, and I did a similar breeding program to his. I was helped by a Dr. Laura Nickel up at Davis, and she helped him with the genetics. I stored a lot of semen in the cryogenics bank, and I would use it to selective females. What makes it such a great breed is it was bred as a guardian companion. And they're fabulous with children. They know their place in the family. They know, you know, that when daddy's gone, the dog steps up. That dog will not try to knock anybody out of the box. It's not going to try to bump somebody in the pecking order. It knows its pecking order. And when it's time to step up, it steps up. They're remarkable animals. Just to create the F1 breeding stock was 7 years to begin with. And it took a total of about 19 years to actually produce dogs that were showing phenotype, the typing of the dog, meaning I wanted a dog with a skull that was a 2 to 3, from the octopole to the stop, with a powerful set of jaws. I wanted a wide chest, but a dog that had great lateral movement. I want a straight top line, but good angulation in the back end. And I don't want the paws going straight in the front. I want them a little bit out each way, which helps with the lateral movement. I wanted a canine athlete with a phenomenal temperament, a temperament that would be, you know, a dog could be around children and be in roughhoused, etc., and be gentle with the kids, and yet somebody breaches your property, the dog, you know, turns right into a Secret Service agent and goes to work. Part of that, Zeke, is that knowing the different breeds, I put in breeds that had a defense drive on a 1 to 10. Most Mastiff defense drive is like a 8 or a 9. We're not talking about the Neapolitan Mastiff of today. This was 40 years ago. So we're talking about the Neo back then. And those dogs were very defensive animals, but they weren't aggressive dogs. So in other words, they didn't have a high prey drive like a dog like a Malinois or a Czechoslovakian Border Patrol dog, a Shepherd that's, you know, Czech lines or Czech Republic dog. Those dogs have a high prey drive. I didn't want a high prey drive. I wanted a high defense drive. So what I did was I brought in breeds and specimens of breeds that showed me what I was looking for. I wanted tenacity and I wanted courage. So I wanted a dog that was going to be courageous and a dog that was going to be there all day. And I also wanted a dog that was virtually insensitive to pain, because, you know, what good's a dog if, you know, somebody stabs him, breaks through your door or stabs him and your dog cowers. So I wanted a dog that was, you know, that could do all those things. And in order to get that, I had to get the right breeds and the right specimens. So they're a guardian companion. And so their use is to be a family dog, a guardian companion. In this world that we're living in today, that's becoming more and more important. You know, with home invasions on the rise, and you know, people constantly, you know, frightened for their lives, living in the city. Yeah, it's important that a person have a dog that can work. But they, you know, like I said, it's important also that you have a family member. A dog can become a part of the family, a member of the family. So, yeah, that's what they do. They're a guardian companion. At night, I don't have to worry about a thing. I have my dogs there, and my dog will take care of business. Very even, balanced temperament. Like I said, they're not an aggressive breed. They're not the kind of dog that is going to attack somebody. They're not, you know, trying to get out the car and get somebody. I'm a strong proponent to obedience training any dog. I don't care how old it is or how young it is or what breed it is. I think it's imperative that a person obedience train this dog for a couple of reasons. One, I think that obedience training your dog helps you to bond with your dog. And two, and just as importantly, there are less than 1% of the dogs that are found in kill shelters that are obedience trained. So if a person obedience trains their dog, they've made an investment. They've made an emotional investment as well as a financial investment. You know, once you obedience train a dog, you have a foundation. And once you have a foundation, you can do all sorts of things with your dog. But that's your foundation. Once that happens, you start taking your dog out. There's plenty of places today where you can take your dog. There's Petco, PetSmart, where people understand, you know, this dog's in training. And then there's vests you can buy with little stickers that go on the side, little Velcro stickers that say, dog in training, please don't pet, or whatever. And so there's a lot of different ways to do exactly that. I would suggest that if you buy an Ambullneo Mastiff, either get him trained from us or you get him trained from somebody else. But they all, I believe that the dog has to have a obedience base. And I also believe it's very important for the person who owns the dog to be attending those classes. As soon as a puppy is 4 weeks, then we start weaning the pup. And once a puppy starts getting weaned, the minute that they, you know, they open their eyes at 12 days, so they know who we are. And they let us know that they know who we are when we walk in the door and they all go crazy. And so, yeah, I think it's very important to make sure that once they start getting their inoculations, that they get introduced to all different types of things. I start up my motorcycle. I do lots of things to make them so that they're not afraid. And I throw pan, when I go in to feed them, I throw their pan in the air and it goes bam, bing, bing, bang, bing. And it's a big donut pan. And then I fill it up. And so that's how we start. And then I encourage people to take their dog with them once they've had their third shot. I encourage them to take their dog everywhere they can. And it's important that the dog is socialized, because the dog is going to know the difference when he's at home and when he's out there. When he's at home, he'll put himself into protective mode. I personally think that a raw diet is a great, great diet to give a dog. So if you can afford to give your dog a raw diet, then I would do that. And there's several raw diets to choose from. But across the board, that would probably be the best one. There's rough greens and there's, you know, lots of things you can add, supplements, you know, because again, they say, you know, if you're feeding a dry food, it's dead food. So it's, you know, you can always put something on top of it that stimulates the, you know, the metabolism in the dog's flora. The dog is supposed to be, I mean, if you want the standard, you know, verbatim, it's on the National Kennel Club website. But I believe it's 24 at the shoulder, and males are 140 to 150 and females are 20 pounds less. I've had some dogs that were bigger than that. But across the board, that's the standard. The life expectancy of the Ambullneo Mastiff is 12 to 14 years. I've had some dogs that live 16, and I've had some that lived 10. And so across the board, it averages somewhere between 12 and 14 years. So as far as cropping and docking are concerned, we don't dock ever. A dog has a natural tail. It's like a rudder. They use it for balance. And like I said, these dogs have a great lateral movement, and I want to continue that. So yeah, we don't do anything like that. As far as cropping goes, some of the breeds that are involved in this breeding program, their ears lay down flat. Now, if they were half prick, we wouldn't have to do anything because there'd be a lot of ventilation. But because they're, a lot of times they lay down flat, people that don't get that done may run into a problem with yeast infections. So I crop all my dogs' ears when they're puppies. I do it when they're 6 weeks old. I take them to my vet. My vet puts them under, crops their ears. We give them a steroid, et cetera, so that they don't feel it. You know, they don't even itch it. And then 10 days later, we take out the sutures. We stretch the ears one time. We do a medium lobe, medium bell, medium length crop. And like I said, the only reason we do it, it's not, you know, it's not for aesthetic reasons. We do it because we want to make sure that the dog doesn't get a yeast infection. And that's one of the best ways to do it. The health issues for any large breed would be hips. One of the things that I can say about that is when the dog is a puppy, a lot of times the person will throw a ball for the puppy, and then they'll say, when the pup brings it back, they'll keep doing that. They'll say, yeah, he loves that. He loves that. No, he doesn't love that. He loves you. What he wants to do is go on a walk with you. If you look at coyotes or wolves, they're never running unless they're running for their life or they're trying to kill some food. The rest of the time, they're loping. So they're just kind of cruising. Or they're walking, they're trudging, they're walking, you know, with purpose. So I think that throwing a ball is a lazy man's way of putting his dog in shape. And on a big breed, any big breed, it's not a good idea to do that. Now, that being said, when we first started this breeding program over 40 years ago, we were using excellent. So the OFA standard is fair, poor, fair, good, and excellent. And we only bred excellent to excellent and excellent to good. We never bred good to good. So it's always one of the two was excellent, and most of the time both dogs were excellent. And that was OFA, and that was back in the day when we first started that. Now, since then, there's been people that have used a pin hip. And they come back and call me up and say, hey, the pin hip was 4.9 or whatever, and it was really good, etc. And so the dogs are bred to have tight hips. But it doesn't matter if their hips are tight or not when they're a puppy. If you're throwing that and the bones are still pliable and it starts moving around in there, it's going to mushroom. And when that dog gets bigger, it's going to displace. So it's not a good idea to do that. It is an excellent idea to put your dog on a leash and take him for a long walk every day. It's good for you and it's good for your dog. So the ideal owner for an Ambullneo Mastiff is a person who understands large dogs, a person who wants a dog to be a part of the family, not some dog that's going to be put out in the backyard and forgotten about. A dog that they're going to take the time and the effort and the energy to bond with, so that dog feels like it's part of the family. Like I was saying, obedience training is the basics. And then once that's done, the dog can learn anything. They're highly intelligent. I had a guy one time call me up and say, my wife's going to have a baby. I don't know how the dog's going to do with the baby. And so I'm going to have to find him a home. And I told the guy, I said, listen, before you do that, why don't you let the dog start smelling the baby through the, you know, with your wife? And I said, your wife handle the dog? He says, oh yeah, he's all obedience, this, that, and the other. I said, man, you can teach an Ambullneo anything in 5 minutes, anything, once it's got that obedience. So why are you thinking like this? And he said, you know what? I overreacted. I'll try it. 3 years later, he called me and said, that dog takes a bath with my son. True story. The activity of an Ambullneo is really more what's the activity level of the owner. So the Ambullneo will do whatever it needs to do to keep up with the owner. And it wants to be there with the owner. It wants to be there with the kids, with the family, with the wife. It wants to be part of the family. So if the family's an active family, you're going to have an active dog. Just like if the family wants to chill, Netflix and chill, your dog's going to want to Netflix and chill. But you can't, you don't have to worry about this dog needing a job. His job is to be with you. In fact, I sold a puppy to a guy, and he just took his dog back to Texas. They came out here and picked the dog up and sold a puppy to him. And he was just sending me some text messages saying that his dog stays about 6 feet away from him or his wife at all times. And if he gets up to go to the restroom, the dog will be at the door when he opens it to come back out. It's a guardian companion. It needs to be able to be inside and outside. Anytime a guardian companion is outside, he's not helping you if somebody gets through, breaches your property through a window or whatever. They have a thick undercoat. When I sell dogs to people in Canada and colder climates, they get this thick undercoat so they can live in very cold weather. But they also shed once a year so they can live in a place like Southern California. But it's imperative that you have a lot of shade and plenty of water, because they do like to drink water. The level of dog aggression in the breed is pretty much slim to none. I mean, they're not an aggressive dog. What I learned early on, as a kid, being around American Pit Bull Terriers and German Shepherds and other breeds, was a dog that's aggressive towards dogs is not usually good as a protection dog. So one of the things we had to get rid of was all that dog aggression. And so we did everything in our power to breed that out. And so for the most part, the Ambullneo is, they're very comfortable with all breeds. They have to be as a guardian companion. You can't take a guardian companion somewhere where it's going to be around other dogs if you have to worry about them constantly fighting with them. So the thing that I would have a person do that was looking to buy an Ambullneo Mastiff was, I would say, read as much as you can about the breed. And then call me. I'm more than happy to talk to people. I've talked to thousands of people in the past 40 years over the telephone and in person. And I'll answer most of your questions, all of your questions, if I can. I'll do my level best. And then, once a person has that information, I believe information is power. And in order to make a purchasing decision, they need to have the right information so they know this is the right breed for them. That's what I would say. My personal website for my breed is ambullneo.net. And it's spelled ambullneo.net. And that's my kennel and my breed.